throughout my life, I've never met a guru, someone externally, a spiritual teacher, a spiritual helper, nothing. So it always felt abandoned here, kind of, all alone and with no help. So I said, you know, I wonder if there's others like me, or younger people in the world now who are going through the same experience. And I said, I have to do something about this, because I felt it was terrible, absolutely terrible, what I went through, like a spiritual orphan. So there's still some watching the videos, and I don't want to just, you know, forsake them. They're getting something out of it. But the spiritual help I've gotten has always been internal, through dreams, and external through circumstances, grace of God, but never a guru or external teacher or guru. I've never met one. I've never come across a spiritual person in my life, actually, externally. In terms of an actual meeting and transmission and help and dialogue and stuff, I mean, it just has never happened. So that's not good, is it? But it's interesting in that these times are so perilous that really only the Dharma Kings can help us out right now. And so that's where I've gotten all the help. I've had so many experiences with the Dharma Kings, the really, really top heavyweight gurus in history. So they must have known that you know, the external teachers at this point don't, you know, aren't enough. And if we over rely on them, it's not going to work so well. So I've always emphasized the Dharma Kings, aim, you know, get yourself ready for contact with them. It's very, very important, because these times are really. To illustrate it, we could say, what is this world? It's really a very devious device, this world. It's so devious, we don't understand how devious it is. It's a collective effort. It's like the many aspects of the one mind got together and became kind of a movement, like said, let's see if we can establish a different mind, which would mean an abnormal mind. We'd have to change the mind, since the mind is one with God. We'd have to change God. And so we're trying to create an abnormal mind. We want the mind to function abnormally. And what's crucial to hear is that either the mind's functioning normally or abnormally. There's nothing in between. Okay. And if the mind cannot function abnormally, then it's just mere pretense. There's nothing other than that. There's no progress. There's nothing. There's no partial abnormality at all. Okay, so this is really the heart of the teaching of whatever high path you want to talk about. It's really getting to just this. You either accept what we are as it is, or we abandon as it is. Either acceptance or abandonment. There's nothing in between. So the teaching, the practice is always to hammer this point home. There's nothing in between. There's no in between. So to be lost in illusion, delusion, samsara, maya, is to believe there's an in between, and we're working on it, working on something, and there's been some progress, and as gradually we're, you know, that no. And looking back in retrospect, I see that this is what trips me up constantly, is this issue. It is so prevalent in our minds. Why is that? Well, because we collectively thought that we could find a way to make the mind abnormal. And we did this by collectively imagining together a certain dream of parameters of experiencing that was the same. We kept doing it the same. And by doing this, we built up what's called, we would say, expectations. It's like the sun rises in the east and sets in the west here. We expect that, right? So this entire world is just a collective dream of aspects of the mind, that the one mind, that is set up to make us believe in expectations. We expect all the physics and biochemistry and all the parameters of this world. We expect we get up in the morning, the sky will be up and the ground will be down, and we'll be the sun will rise in the east, set in the west, and everything will continue on as it does. But this is all a collective dream to instill expectations in us. And then we hope that from just massive familiarity with these expectations, sun always rising in the east, setting in the west, for instance, that this will cause the mind to be fixated, and then the mind will be abnormal. So it's really our very devious, clever way of trying to make the mind abnormal. That's all that it is. So it's been a vast, extremely extensive effort by many, many, many aspects of mind collectively working together. And they keep saying, together we can do it. If we just keep on imagining that everything works this way, nature, this is the way of nature, claiming there's something actually called nature, which there isn't. It's all our just imagination. That ultimately this will result in inducing the mind to finally fixate if we just keep at it long enough. So the thing is like an endurance contest. We're trying to just keep on steadily believing that we are living in this dream, and this is the way things are, and it's all fixated. It's all well, all everything we expect everything to go the way that it goes. We expect the gravity, for instance, to always be in place. So we have all these inviolate principles that we're dreaming of. And what we don't like here is for those principles to not work so well. And that freaks us out. Because we say, well, hey, we can't reach our goal of abnormal mind if that's the case. So, for instance, when you see saints levitate, people say, whoa, 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 you can't do that. But yet the saint is doing it, is levitating. The saint's levitating. And people say, well, wait a minute, how's that possible? It makes you stop and say, wait, wait, wait a second here. Something isn't right. So the greatness, the helpfulness of saints, one of the many ways they're helpful, is that they don't go along all the time with this collective imagination of trying to imagine together the same experiencing together as if, and then to build up these expectations. Well, that's the way it's just always go, always is. That's it's set somehow. They don't go along with that. Jesus raised people from the dead. They see people say, you can't do that, they're dead. He raised himself from the dead. And they say, whoa, 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 wait, wait. We're imagining that when you die, you can't come back to life, and you just came back to life. That's violating, that violates us. We're, our dream has been violated. They get very angry about that, very upset and arrogant about it. But of course, all they're trying to do is to change reality, which is totally arrogant and cannot be changed. So in truth, this entire universe is just this attempt to fixate the mind, fixate it, instead of being free, trying to fixate it. It's all collective imagination. But it seems to have so much power in because it's collectively so much collective effort has gone into it that we think, well, I can't go contrary to that. That's somehow a taboo or something, like you're violating God or something. But no, we're not violating God. God didn't create us to change God. We did. God didn't say we can't try, but God does say we can't do it. But we're trying to an extreme extent. So does the sun really rise in the east? No. A dream sun is collectively being dreamed. There's principles of celestial mechanics. That's all being dreamed to try and convince us that this is just going to be expected forever and ever and ever, right? Like the universe go trillions of years, whatever. It's always going to be this way. And then this is an attempt to then fixate the mind when we look at it and say, oh my gosh, there's no way out. You know, this is, we just live in a predetermined reality where everything functions mechanically this way. It's an attempt to demoralize us to such an extent that it induces mental fixation. But the mind cannot be fixated. So it just induces despair, actually. Well, we have a very large, boisterous procession down the street here. It's unbelievable. Not what you want to be involved in is boisterousness, okay? You can just hear the babbling of it, right? You see how terrible that is? That's the profane world right there. Either that or Padmasambhava is coming down the street. And everybody's... rejoicing. But I think it would be a little more, beautiful if it was Padmasambhava coming. But he's welcome to come down this street anytime. In fact, right now. So speaking of Padmasambhava, you know, he consistently did things that we didn't expect were possible. He's one of the greatest miracle workers in history, without any question. In fact, his miracles just seemed never ending. First, he just appeared here. Okay, he was not born of parents. Secondly, he left here just turning into a light body, like Jesus did. Didn't die. Okay, so that's just for starters. And then in between, there's everything in between. Okay. Every kind of miracle imaginable. Padmasambhava would just fly with his group, some of his those who were with him, just locate somewhere, just from southern India, come up somewhere. None of the so-called laws of nature apply to Padmasambhava. He'd go along with some of them, and then ignore others when he needed to ignore them. He just ignored them. And this left people like kind of, super astonished. Jesus the same way. You're healed. People said, you can't do that. I mean, no, that's those things are part of nature. You know, Jesus said, no, get up and walk like that. So again, they say that Jesus did so many miracles, all the books in the world couldn't hold how many did. He just continuously paid no heed to our attempts to fixate the mind through dream of celestial mechanics and nature. And again, it's just a capricious dream. What trips us up is we're all dreaming the same dream. We've all decided to dream pretty much the same dream to try and trick ourselves. Okay, that's what trips us up. There's so many aspects of mind have joined in to agree that they're going to imagine the same parameters. And so there's very few instances of those ignoring these parameters. And so therefore, that is supposed to trick the mind into thinking, well, that God must have set this all up. This must be God's will. And then that should then induce the mind into fixation. This is the trick. We're trying to deceive ourselves. That's all there is to it. So the saints come in and they just ignore a lot of this, these so-called laws of nature. They just ignore it. And we're all kind of like astonished, like, well, you can't just appear, you know. Yogananda's book, Autobiography of Yogi, has many, many, many examples. But the Tibetans, if you dig into it, just tremendous amount of examples. Christian history, the same. You go back through history, and if you're willing to look at it, which I have my whole life, I've been very willing to look at and study and pay attention to all this. You just realize that throughout history, there's just been massive amount of just ignoring a lot of this collective imagination of attempt to fixate the mind. Yeah, Jesus said, give me some bread and here you go. Let's feed thousands of people. Just multiply the loaves, right? You need, ran out of wine? I'll get some water. Okay, turn it into wine. Here, let me walk on water. All right. No problem. Let me calm the storm. No problem. Let me raise from the dead. Let me heal. Let me become invisible to people. Whatever Jesus needed to do, he just did it. He just did it. People marvel at it. Well, wait a minute, you know, that's amazing, but you can't do that. You know, who gave you the authority to do that? They had to try to figure out, like, wait a minute, how come he obeys nature sometimes and other times doesn't? Well, he must have a dual nature, human and divine. No, he just knew the deviousness of this dream, and he came to show us that it's just a dream, a capricious collective willingness for us to try and deceive ourselves by imagining the same parameters. Call them laws of nature. None of those apply to us. We're spirit. The only law that applies to us is freedom to be whatever we want to experience, to experience whatever it is we want to experience, to be the experience of it. That's the only law there is. We're not bound by any universe at all or any laws at all. It's all made up, totally made up. So it's very important just to hear this. It's not spoken of hardly ever, actually, except the Dharma kings do bring it to light somewhat. Jesus certainly has brought it to light for me to a great extent, and I'm sort of emphasizing it here in a very strong way, which is hard to do in a book. In a book, you only, you know, so many pages. You don't want the book to be endlessly large. So Jesus was written, had a couple books written here, A Course in Miracles and Journey Beyond Words and The Other Voice. And I tend to focus on Journey Beyond Words. Dr. Brent Haskell heard Jesus speaking to him and tape recorded it and then transcribed from the tape recordings, you know, into written manuscript, book turned into a book. And I tend to rely on that for the most really advanced, clear, adamant teachings of Jesus. And then from that, I'm able to do a video, this video, for instance, where I'm able to really expound upon it. So that's like being an apostle of Jesus. I'm an apostle of Jesus in that I expound upon his very key points and kind of help people get familiar with it. Whereas in the book, he touches upon it, but he doesn't want to overdo it, because that itself, first you need to start by bringing it to light, which you did, and then give us a chance to get used to it. And then later on, we can begin listening to it being expounded upon a little bit and emphasized. Don't want to overload in book form. I overloaded last night. I read too much of the book, and I got toxic. I felt, too many words. So you don't want to read too much. Unless you know you're a masochist, which we used to be. A Course in Miracles is so many words, and finally I reached a point where I said, Jesus, I just can't handle all these words. And Jesus says, good, let's move on to the next. And then I found Journey Beyond Words. I said, that's so wonderful, kind of poetic form, where the page is just not completely filled up with a wall of words. And but even that now is if I read too much of it, I feel like it's toxic. Words can become toxic. It's a page, you know, with these black marks on it, and you're just reading this, and don't read too much. And then a video is less toxic in terms of, because it's just spoken, and there's inflection and gestures, and there's pauses, and it's kind of much more live than just a blank, you know, just a page just sitting in front of you. That's pretty difficult to deal with. So we'll just let this sink in. It's, you know, I'm sure it's quite astonishing to hear this. Quite astonishing indeed. And that just needs to, you know, sink in and wow this. Say, I have a perfect world. Wow. I abandon my perfect world. Wow. I have a perfect world. Wow, I've abandoned my perfect world. What is my perfect world? Whatever I want it to be, right? That's my perfect world. And then when we abandon our perfect world, we end up with a stream of parameters, expectations, which make us feel that we must be fixated. We keep believing it. It's not true. It's not true, but we keep believing it and as if it will become true. So becoming, right? There's no becoming. We either accept that we have a perfect world or we abandon our perfect world. There's no becoming. We don't become imperfect. No, we don't become perfect. We either accept our perfection or we imagine that we've abandoned our perfection. Really, we abandon it in our minds. We make this decision to pretend, which is abandonment. I'm just using this term. We don't literally leave it, but it's very important we don't separate from it. We don't separate from it. But in our experience, it's as if we have abandoned it. There's no leaving. There's no gradualism to it. It's cut and dried. Cut and dried. We either accept ourselves as we are, the mind as it is, or we attempt to abandon it, actually. It's an abandonment. Either or. It's an either or situation. And so you don't want to get tricky about this. You want to practice either or-ness. I have a perfect world. I love my perfect world. Wow. I've abandoned my perfect world. Wow. I have a perfect world. Wow. I've abandoned my perfect world. Wow. So this is the key to practicing. It's either you have it or you've abandoned it. Either you have it or you've abandoned it. You're in the spirit of abandonment. We put it this way. When we say abandon, we mean you're in the spirit of the arrogance of abandonment. It's one of the two. Jesus says there's two emotions, love or fear. Only two. There's no in between. There's no in between. You cannot have a lovely fear or a fearful love. So the emphasis of Jesus and the great the Dharma kings is to just either or. You cannot have it both ways, and you cannot have it in between, any in between ways. That constitutes the delusion of waiting for becoming, for expectations to become fixation. There's no fixation ever. And having expectations is abandoning reality, abandoning our home. We don't have any, reality doesn't have any expectations. There's no such thing as expectations or evaluations in reality. This is completely artificial, this nature, this world, totally artificial. So it's a great thing to just forget this world, forget about it. I tried that last night. I said, I'm just finished with this world. I'm just going to imagine a different world. Why not? There could still be expectations in that world, but it's a step back towards reality, as it were, to just imagine a different world than this, right? Because that breaks the spell of this world. If you can say, well, I can just go to another world where stuff is different. Maybe in that world the sun rises in the east one day and rises in the west the other. Maybe from the south and from the east, or maybe it just stays in the sky, doesn't move. Or maybe it changes around depending, right? So the parameters may be not so set in that world. You imagine beautiful butterflies and suddenly there they are. Whereas here we say, well, that can't happen. I mean, right? We can't just decide we want to experience something and we experience it, because we only that which nature is producing can we experience. That's what we're imagining. So it can be very helpful to reshape our expectations, to just decide I'm going to go to another world. I'm just going to abandon this world, right, and go to another world. So abandon abandonment. Abandon the spirit of abandonment, or at least make an effort to. Take a little step. Okay. It's still the spirit of abandonment, but we're lessening it. We're getting familiar with the notion of setting it down, setting abandonment down. So I just imagined that, I'm just going to a different world. I've completely forgot about this world. No interest in it whatsoever. And we shouldn't have any interest in this world, actually. It's designed to destroy us, really. I mean, try to change what we are. So I'd rather be in a world where everything is much more pliable, where the so-called laws, or so-called expectations, the laws of nature, are very pliable, where it's easier to see, hey, wait a minute, this is obviously just a dream because I just decided that, the mountain is going to move over here. Let me rearrange the landscape and say, okay. And then let me rearrange it again. It's nice. And let me have, the leaves, instead of falling down, they're falling upward. That'd be fun, right? The rain comes up from the ground and it goes up into the sky. you could have flower petals falling everywhere. That's something that many saints have done, is just having flowers fall from the sky. Many, many things the saints have done. You name it, they've done it. Seemingly contravening the so-called inviolate laws of nature. Which is why science is a total waste of time. Total waste of time. They think they're studying reality. No, they're just studying a collective dream, which is just all capricious. So what's the point of it? None of it's real. None of it will all pass away, this nonsense. So why waste time in measurement and analysis and all this? That's ridiculous. I tend not to measure anything or I don't like quantifying or measure. I don't like any of that stuff. It's just not even interested in the world. How it works? Why study how the world works? What do you mean how it works? How does a dream work? I mean, how does the content in a dream work? There's no working of content in a dream. It's all just a desire of the dreamers. In this case, the dreamers. To dream a similar dream, a collective dream. We're all trying to dream the same. So they'll say, see what happens if we all try to dream the same dream. There's no laws in this dream. There's nothing real to no things, actually, at all. So why study? Why study anything here? That's why we're able to detach from this world. You hear that saints detach from the world and are disinterested and disengage and turn to the inner landscape where they can change it at will. And we hear there's something sacred about this world. It's a collective dream is sacred. What a collective dream of trying to change the mind is sacred? How is that? It's just a collective dream attempting to do the impossible. What's sacred about that? Everything is sacred. Everything is equally sacred. Our freedom is all there is, and that's sacred. So you can't delineate something as sacred as opposed to something that's not sacred in that way. Everything is sacred. Now, the saints are just ones who point this out. It's everything sacred. And because they do miracles, we tend to think, they're more sacred. They have some higher power of sacredness. No, they just have normal sacredness. They're just normal. We're trying to be abnormal. Saints are just normal. That's just normal mind. That's just mind. And we're trying to be abnormal mind. Keep in mind now that at the opportune time, the Dharma Kings have promised to liberate us, to do what is necessary. Okay, and they will. They will do what's necessary. But only as just before the sun sets. Just before the sun sets, so to speak. Meaning, just before the sun sets on the Dharma in this world, which is coming fast. as the world set, the sun setting in this world, it was symbolizes in the way I'm talking now, going into extreme time, a time of extreme darkness and profane, completely forgetting about the saints, completely forgetting. I spent my whole life trying to keep culture from forget it, from forgetting about the saints. That's why I do so many videos about the Dharma kings. Because having a long lineage of history of all these miracles and have these wonderful brothers and sisters here is so important for us to remember that this is all just a dream and there aren't any laws of nature at all. To forget about that is catastrophic because we're going to then believe we're trapped by whatever nature seems to be doing, however we seem to be dreaming the dream. Following so-called these the laws of the dream, meaning we think we're compelled to dream in a certain way to try and keep, fixate the mind. Everyone will feel like they got no hope. They can't get free of it. They're just stuck in some deterministic universe. And then the idea is it creates so much despair that then it fixates the mind. And then we think, well, I'll be happy then because we've fulfilled our purpose. But there's no way to fulfill that purpose, so we won't be happy. Even if we could, we would destroy everything if we could, but we can't, so we can't be happy that way. And so we're about ready to go into a very unhappy time in the world, very unhappy. But the Dharma kings know that. They showed me 400% for sure. They're very aware of the timing, what's going on here, the collective dream, and the intent of the collective dream. And they will do exactly what needs to be done, exactly the right moment. But it will be late in the game, late in the game. Not overly late, but quite late in the game. But we're late in the game already, right now. So it could be any moment, actually. We're very late in the game. May 22nd is coming quite quickly, isn't it? We're almost done with April. It's like 24 days away, I think, May 22nd. Just 3.5 weeks away. That's a significant day. There's a number of significant days. September, what, 23rd, October 11th. There's a lot of significant days coming up where, as we sink into this very profane pit of spiritual darkness, that the Dharma kings will, make their move, make their move. So we just need to be generally familiar, of the general territory, and understand we may very well find ourselves in a more pliable natural nature scenario. If we want something, a bird to show up, a bird will show up. And if we want to talk to the bird, we can talk to the bird. And the bird, will sing us a song, bird, and the bird will sing us a song. And it's like that. Nature is very is much more compliant. It doesn't mean we have to do away with trees and water and shrubs and flowers and sky and what we're used to. We don't have to do away with that. It's just it becomes much more pliant, compliant. Also, we said, tree, I want you to produce, apricots or peaches or something, apples, whatever, fruit. Produce tree, I like to have some really nice fruit. And the tree produces the fruit. Like that. And I'd like some beautiful flowers to appear on the shrub there, and the flowers appear for you, beautifully appear. But it still seems within certain parameters of nature, right? But we start realizing, hey, this world is much more compliant and pliable than we thought possible. You see, it's like that. Some people call this the astral realm. Astral realm. Yes, well, there still tends to be some vagueness of bodies there, apparently. But many dwell in the astral realm. And the astral realm is much more compliant, pliable nature is very pliable. If you want to see like a lake and you want to see beautiful patterns on the lake of ripples and stuff, that will happen. And you can just sit there watching this gorgeous light show of shimmering ripples on the lake. And if you want to hear music, you hear music, everything resounding in astonishingly beautiful tones. And just enjoy playing with your environment mentally like this. And this gradually heals us from the notion, reshapes our expectations in the direction of awakening from the dream altogether, any expectations, any set expectations. Expectations mean something, we think something's set or fixated. No, we're just dreaming. So I'm gravitating towards a more pliable nature experience. You want to walk in this morning among a certain type of grove, and you go out there, and lo and behold, there's the grove of trees you wanted to walk under. Next morning you get up, you want to walk under a different grove of trees. There's a different grove of trees right there. If you want the trees to, be singing to you, they sing. Speaking of singing, I was singing pretty well today, actually. Really, really well. Getting my swerve on. Here's another really great example. I love to sing along with really nice songs. Songs I really like. But what I really love about it is the song, the song is the same every time you hear it. And I'll be singing along, and then I'll expect that I'm going to keep singing along with, with the tune. But then suddenly I'll shift and I'll start being creative and doing all sorts of, harmony and stuff that I don't expect to hear. So it really like elevates me. I say, oh my gosh, I didn't know I could do that. I didn't expect to hear that. So I kind of shock myself continuously by singing differently than I expect myself to sing. I'm able to do that. So it's kind of like a type of self-therapy of reshaping expectations, like, well, you're supposed to sing this way because that's the way the song goes, And suddenly I'll just take off like a bird in flight, and I'll just be, ba-ba-da-ba-ba-ba-ba-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da- them, and just, you know, just whatever, blah, 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 along with the music and the tune, and then I'll sing harmony, then shift into the lead, and then I'll do counterpoint off the harmony, and then do different harmonies with the lead, and you know, I never know what I'm going to do. I never know. So I keep my mind just blank, not blank, but I try not to have any expectations of how am I going to sing? How am I going to sing? I don't know. So I practice this all the time. We don't know which way the wind is going to blow. In my mind, I could sing anything at all. But I still try to stay within the context of the song, not trying to be shocking, overly shocking, you know, in that way. That can be counterproductive. So if we go to a different nature experience, we don't have to like do away with flowers, you know. No. Keep the flowers, keep the trees, keep the lakes, keep the mountains, keep the meadows and pastures and the prairie, and you know, keep whatever landscape is beautiful to you and wonderful. But just it's much more pliant. You want to watch snowfall? Then in front of you, this beautiful, beautiful snowflakes are just silently falling with every kind of pattern possible, amazing form, geometric forms, no one the same, and they're large and you can see it. And each one has like a tone, actually a whole orchestral tone through the crystalline structure of the snowflakes. And you're hearing all those tones as they're, you know, falling so quietly and softly and gently. And all those tones are blending into this massive, massive, beautiful symphony of snowflakes falling. So that's just a beautiful example. And so for me, I always expect the world to function this way. And when it doesn't, I'm always so shocked. I said, wait, I said, I told the roses to bloom and they're not blooming. What the heck's the matter with you, roses? You know, what's the matter with this place? It's crazy. It's funny, I told the roses to bloom in the yard all winter. I said, roses, I want you to bloom all winter. And they did. They did. They bloomed all winter. And they're blooming right now. Roses are really blooming everywhere right now, but our roses bloomed all winter long because I told them to, and they finally listened to me. And it's like, wow, that's great. And I pointed it out to people, and they kind of look and say, hey, that's really weird. I've never seen that before. And then they went on with their life, and it didn't make much of an impact on them. But for me, I understood. I asked them to bloom. And I didn't trim the roses back. I just let them keep going, and they, lo and behold, they produce blooms all year round. We'd cut them and bring them inside, and they'd open up inside. So there's an example of a miracle right there, of nature being a little bit compliant, being able to... Now, the world wants to be more pliable. Okay, collective consciousness. We're all tired of this nonsense. There's a miracle. I was walking along a street. I have lots of little miracles, but they're miracles of grace, of attention, sort of. It's not so much like the roses blooming all winter. That's a very rare one. But this one, I was walking along the street. I just noticed this little pebble. I looked at the pebble. I said, I saw this skull. I said, holy cow, there's a skull right there. I've never seen, I don't see those kind of things. I'm not looking for that sort of stuff. But just it struck me, and I said, wow. I said, oh, I don't want a skull. It was a white crystalline type of pebble. With definitely two eyes and a mouth, and it was a skull-like. And I was ready to just kick it away, and I said, wait a minute. Why am I seeing that? That's so unusual. And then I realized Longchenpa's he did most of his writing in White Skull Mountain. White Skull Mountain. And this was a pebble, White Skull Pebble. A White Skull Pebble right there in the road. I was ready just to kick it into the gutter. I said, whoa. So I picked it up and I kept it. I don't do stuff like that. That's very rare. So that's a synchronicity. We the miracles we get here in this world are more like synchronicities, okay? Unusual synchronicities. I've had massive amounts of those, but in this day and age, we don't get so many miracles like flowers flying from the sky. I really miss that. You know, I it's horrible. I just want flowers to fall from the sky. Why can't we have flower petals just fall from the sky? Come on, petals fall. You know, it's ridiculous. That we cannot, it's not happening. And this day and age that we're in right now is so terrible, so profane, that's not happening much anymore. Neither is the rainbow bodies of the Tibetan Dzogchenists. There hasn't been many recently. I mean, maybe just, I don't know, there was one in 1953, I think, and 52 or 53, and I don't know if there's been one other, but it's really rare now. Whereas before, it was very common. Very, very well known in common in hundreds of thousands of instances, you might say, in Tibetan history, of when a yogi, enlightened yogi, decides to leave the body, either shrinks gradually, to dissolves, shrinks away, dissolves, leaving just nails and some hair, or sometimes nothing, or if they decide to cremate it for relics, all these relics appear. Massive amount of relics, all different types, appear. They're able to just dissolve, you know, the body, and all these rainbow lights appear above in that area. Tremendous amount of rainbow lights. Sometimes earthquakes, the ground shakes, there's roaring, there's all sorts of signs, tremendous signs. And so this was so common. Everybody experienced this throughout their history. So many people experienced it. And yet it sort of stopped happening. Does that mean that this fixation is taking place? No. It means that we're just so many materialists have come into the world with science, their science, so obsessed with trying to prove that this is all fixated, that these expectations will go on forever, that we have been, intimidated, I guess, here, to such an extent that we've stopped giving evidence there's no fixation at all. There's nothing set at all in this dream. Nothing's set in a dream. Nothing in a dream is factually set at all. And I've had examples of that in my dreams. Sometimes I was looking out at this ocean. I said, wait a minute, there's mountains. And I said, wait, 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 wait. And I said, I'm going to move this whole landscape. And so I actually pivoted the entire landscape and moved it like that in the dream. I said, that's better. And I said, oh, wow. I can do that, can't I? Yeah. Well, Jesus said if we had faith the size of a mustard seed, we'd tell that mountain, go move over there, and it would move over there. Faith the size of a mustard seed. Mustard seed's a very tiny seed. So he said, even if we had a little bit of faith, we could do this easily. So it's an age of trying to extinguish faith. It's a faithless age right now. Profane, faithless age. To such an extreme extent, it's no use delineating it. It becomes kind of just deplorable and despairing, and just why even bother? We're focused on, what do we do? Let's have a more pliable world. And if we want good waves, the good waves arrive. If you want to surf a certain type of wave, that the ocean provides that wave for you. And it's often been commented on that I said, how did Kelly Slater win 11 world championships? And it's an anomaly, and people have commented on it, and those who have surfed against him and watched his career and stuff, they say, well, it's just kind of like serendipity or something. And he believes in serendipity and living in the now and all this. It's his mind, actually. And they say he always seems to pick the right waves. Well, that's because he's asking for them. Okay, so he's using a little bit of faith. And some of the great athletes do this, actually. Some of the really, the ones that stand out in various ways, they use their minds. They're using their minds in a little bit of the right way. They have faith the size of maybe a tiny bit of a mustard seed. And they say, I want a really good score. I want a really great wave that'll shape up just right and allow me to do these maneuvers. And lo and behold, he's able, the wave comes and he gets it, and everybody's scratching their head and says, wow, he was lucky again. How did he get that wave? It's like that. And we could all do that. But wouldn't it be nice? I'm still working out. I feel like I'm going to be surfing at some point. But in this world, no. I know. I hate it because it's so difficult to find good waves. I mean, being a surfer here is just like, it's terrible. I really hated it. Just hated it because you never know what you're going to get. Your hopes are so high. You're all pumped up. The adrenaline's just pumping. You say, man, and you get there, it's just like, And then you thrash about in the ocean and you come out and say, that was a bad session. I didn't really get much good waves in that kind of way. And nine times out of ten, it's so frustrating, and it's just, you get cranky, like the world's against you kind of thing. It's like, wow, I never can get the good waves. If I was at the pipeline, maybe I'd be getting some. But no, because you have low priority there. The locals rule a lot of places around the world. If you're not a, everyone knows who has priority there. And you take off on someone else's wave there as priority. The locals are gonna, meet you at the beach and say, "Hey, buddy, I don't think you should be surfing here." And they escort you off the beach, so to speak. You don't, so you don't really get the good waves unless you're like Mick Fanning and take helicopter rides down the coast of Western Australia, where like there's nobody there at all. And you find, some beautiful 4 or 5 foot waves peeling off there. Or go to East Africa or something. There's nobody there except the, all sorts of deadly bugs and viruses and sharks and stuff. That's no fun. But imagine if there's a world where you go to the beach. I just want, this is the conditions I want to surf today, and those, there are the conditions. That would be kind of fun. I'd enjoy that. I'd enjoy that. I was watching a wave in Bali. They just had a qualifying series championship in Bali, and the waves are just fabulous. Just tube rides, just, oh man, like curtains. You're just behind a curtain. And that would be a lot of fun. I would enjoy doing something like that. And I wouldn't have, swimmer's ear and bad eyes and everything. I'd just be able to do it because I decided this is what I want to do. That'd be fun, ride all sorts of different waves, different colored waves, different tones of the ocean, different parameters. You can just play with all the parameters. That'd be a lot of fun. So there's a good example. So I'm working out. I keep thinking, God keeps telling me you're going to be surfing. I say, what are you talking about? But yeah, you're going to be surfing. I said, what? I can't see without my glasses. I mean, I don't know. It's a little dangerous to surf when you're 60, actually. You get thrashed out there. But keep saying, yeah, you're going to be surfing. I said, okay, all right. So I'll be doing a lot of stuff. God says, you'll be doing a lot of stuff. I said, well, okay. Maybe in a different world, right? Different realm. Maybe we wouldn't have to work out there. Or we could just have fun, actually. Working out is fun. I have this balance tube, 4-inch PVC tube, I think it's 4-inch, yeah. And walk on that. That's really difficult. I have other stuff I do that's just strength stuff, and awkward strength is good to work on. Or I did that today, really tiring. I do different exercises so I don't get fixated on any particular one, get used to it. I keep trying different stuff that I have never done before. And that's fun. Got home for a long week of work, and Friday afternoon, what I worked out really intensely. So I was just really tired. Did a lot of trampoline work, very intense trampoline work. Yeah, I could feel it. My body's just like, ah. But I'm feeling more and more nimble. So in other words, I'm reshaping my expectations that I'm going to be in a world where I can do like all sorts of stuff. I mean, I would have loved to have been like a surfer, travel the world to all these different places. That when I was growing up, that was something that I really wanted to do. What we watched the movie Endless Summer, and that's what they did. They just kind of followed summer around the world and went to all these fantastic surf places. It's still a super iconic movie, The Endless Summer. And we watched that when it first came out. And that really made such an impression on me. I said, wow, I want to do that. That's what I want to do. I just want to be this perpetual beach bum, and just hang out at the beach and surf. Surf and sing. Singing and play acoustic guitar and just play the guitar and sing and surf. And I used to do that. I used to bring my guitar to the beach and just play acoustic guitar. I didn't sing. I didn't want to get into singing at that point. If you start sounding and singing too good, people then grab a hold of you and say, oh, gotta play for us. Dear Mr. Fantasy, play a solid tune, something that'll make us all happy. You are the one that, something how it goes, like, you're the one that knows how to do this, so do this for us. Make us happy in our dreadful prison of imagined fixation. Of expect imagined laws of nature, right? What a dreadful prison for spirit. Dreadful prison. Spirit, it can't stand this dream. It's such a horrible dream for spirit. So and for those who just forlorn, they want to hear a song. But the only problem is if you don't do it the way they expect, then they don't like that. So I'm not going to sing a song the way they expect. For me, that's boring. I want to sing it in a way that I don't expect. So when we used to play a guitar band, we'd all just jam, and we never knew what we were going to play. We never knew what we were going to do next. And that was really, really cool. We didn't do songs, actually. And it sounded like anarchy or something, but we were all just doing whatever came to mind, like, let me try this. And so we were doing all this stuff we don't expect. We were trying to break through this illusion of expectations in this world. So we made some, I've made some great efforts to do so. And not enough, apparently, in terms of, right now the world, it couldn't turn it around, couldn't turn culture around. But we may be headed for the promised land. The promised land is a place, land of milk and honey, meaning a land where you want, beautiful 4 to 5 foot waves, great tube rides with some nice shoulders, like lower trestles. The trestle's not really tube rides, but this wave in Bali was like that. Cahome or something like that. Beautiful, perfect conditions, and you go to the beach and there it is. And then you hang out and you might have like people just wandering around. They all can sing and play guitar or whatever, and you just join in with people. They're singing a song. You join in and you sing it different, and they all appreciate that. Say, "Oh, I didn't expect that. That's beautiful." And you walk down the beach and there's some other people singing, and you just join in. What they're singing, and you add your voice to it, and then they walk down the beach and join. And you just have this kind of free floating beach party of different people, singing songs and surfing. That would be fun. I could get with that for sure. So I'm still practicing singing. The creativity is more important than the tone of voice, actually. When you start to sing very creatively with confidence that you can just go any which way, then that's good. Today I was that way. And I keep working at it. I keep working at it. It's so easy to fall into imagined fixation here. Like, I just need to sing along with, what the singer is singing. And then you're kind of dead. But I keep pushing through that barrier and say, no, I'm going to sing this way. And then the next time this way. And the next time that way. And I don't repeat myself really the way that I sing. I don't tend not to repeat myself. I keep doing it different ways. The Wanderer by Dion is a great song to harmonize with. Some songs just invite harmonizing. As soon as that song comes on, I can just sing it in any which way. It's amazing. Whereas other songs, I have a real hard time breaking out of the set tune. But that one, wow, it just invites it. It's amazing. You can really syncopate and counterpoint in every which way off of that song. And so I do a lot of syncopating with the beat and all that. And just break it up, and then hold it a little longer than you're supposed to, and then swoop in a little later than you're supposed to, and play with the whole tempo and all that, but agilely and in a beautiful way. So you kind of smile and say, I like that. I like that. That was very pliant and very flexible, but it was done in a beautiful way. And sometimes I'd sing out of tune on purpose and then bring it back into tune just to play with the whole tonal sort of thing, but in a beautiful way, not in like we're trying to grate on our nerves or something. No, we want to do it in a beautiful way, so we're attracted to this pliancy. Not in an anarchist type of way at all. No, I still respect the flow of what's there and stay, I amplify and beautify in the flow. We're not trying to show off just how much we can disregard everything. We're doing it in a gentle, beautiful way, gentle glory way, Manjushri gentle glory way. And then you can have others that are just playing with flowers blooming along the beach, along the bluff of a beach or something, and there's always this show of beautiful flowers blooming, and as others are walking around singing, their thing is singing. So, and they see the beautiful different flowers blooming, they get inspiration to sing in a certain way, and they see the beautiful waves breaking with a soft hush of the surf, and that inspires also more beautiful singing, more beautiful flowers, more beautiful waves, more beautiful atmosphere and clouds and ambience and all that. And that's a pretty cool place to hang out, isn't it? And the big thing, remember, there's no attraction among bodies at all there. No attraction among bodies at all. You're not attracted to anyone in a body way or physical way at all. Isn't that beautiful? Isn't that wonderful? Absolutely, it is. Give up trying to see bodies. Bodies are actually horrible. Really. We're pretending they're so beautiful, they're not. Probably the worst aspect of this world is bodies. Having to, see bodies. It's just, I've always hated seeing bodies. So I said, I can't stop seeing bodies. I want to find a beautiful body so at least I can see something beautiful because the bodies are so hideous and horrible. If you go around and really look at people, honestly, bodies rather, bodies, not people, bodies, you just say, oh my God, it's hideous. It's a show of hideousness, actually. That's why we're attracted to more beautiful bodies. We just, it, because we just, we're like, well, we're just repulsed by bodies, actually. And we just say, please, give me at least something I can look at. But then you look more closely at those beautiful bodies, and they're repulsive, too. Bodies are very, very repulsive, actually. So bodies in a more pliant world will be more vague and kind of just archetypal sort of thing. It's not the body, it's the spirit, it's the creativity. It's the creativity. And everything is just being done there just for the love of it. We're not trying to be attract someone to ourself, to our bodies, to some body self or something like that. It's not like that at all. And it's pretty easy. Once you get in that vibe, it's pretty easy. It's really easy. Once all these cultural norms of this world are dropped, then we say, oh yeah, I enjoy this much more. I'm not attracted to bodies. What that was hell, actually. Attraction to bodies is hell. I can't imagine a worse hell than being attracted to bodies. Really, that's the worst. They're corpses. I mean, most people are walking corpses. I have a friend right now who's unfortunately another friend, one dying of lung cancer or trying to live with it, and another trying to live with leukemia, and it's not going very well for him, and apparently he's really not looking so good, to say the least. Not that he ever did look good, but he's looking 10 times worse right now. But a beautiful soul, a beautiful soul. We're all beautiful souls, actually. It's just bodies are horrible. God's all, at least somehow, my spirit's always made sure that I had some disfigurements or marks or something that didn't look so good with me, so that people would not be attracted, so much to this body. It's the mind that's beautiful, not the body. Body is if you just really look at it, it's, oh gosh, what? I'm supposed to like be attracted to body? What? Are you kidding me? I'm spirit. Not a body. I'm attracted to freedom, the flow of creativity without parameters of expectations around it. But again, we need to get used to reshaping our expectations towards no expectations. So we certainly tried. I mean, youth keeps trying, don't they? I mean, we tried in my youth, we tried. I tried to just generate miracles, go to the beach. I tried to generate great waves. I tried to generate flowers and great music and stuff, and it didn't happen. We tried. I remember somebody tried. They had a band at the beach and they're playing great music. They're playing. It was just like really awesome, the music they were playing. We tried, but you know, there were drugs there and a lot of vixens, you know, kind of wasteful, wasted minds and degenerate minds and all this. There was, you know, it was all kind of a mixture of stuff and you know, just like we tried. We tried. My best friend died in an auto accident coming home from one of those beach parties. And I realized, you know, that was dangerous territory, actually. I said, man, you know, it's we're trying. You bring down, you got generators, you hook up amplifiers, put up a little stage maybe there on the beach, and play beautiful music there, and you have the, you know, the sunset and the waves, and people bring, they bring beer, of course, alcohol, drugs, and everything, and you dance, and we just kind of feel. So they were trying to, you know, bring that into this world, but it always seems to backfire and not go the way we really want it to go. But we have to give ourselves kudos for trying, right? It just shows how desperate we are for a more pliant dream, right? So we could have a more pliant dream. There's nothing preventing us from having a more pliant dream. We're all, in some ways, you know, hoping for that and trying for it, but we need to be very conscious of this, what we're really after and why we're after it and why it's possible. And you don't really have to die for that, actually, either. You do not have to die. That's interesting. That itself is an expectation that we're imagining. Death. That's all it is. Just that symbolizes fixation for us. It's a very strong symbol of fixation. That the mind, we equate the body with the mind with the body, and then the body's fixated and can't function anymore. We think the mind has somehow died, and now it's just these parameters are you know, nothing can change it. The mind's dead, and so this dream now then it becomes reality. Except, of course, if the mind was dead, there wouldn't be any dream. Let's see. So, I don't know. We got some revelers out there, and they're trying in their own way to, you know, not go along with the expectations of this world. But we get rebels, you know, without a cause. James D. We people, you know, youngsters rebel. They say, hey, they might have come from a more pliant realm, and they come here and they say, this is horrible. I want things to go a certain way, and they don't go that way here. And it's devastating here. I mean, I got so depressed, so devastated. I said, what in the world? This world's terrible. What does it matter with this world? You come from a more pliant realm into this one. So you want to be conscious of the whole situation so you don't come back to this realm. So you go to a more pliant realm, and then from there, an even more pliant realm, and you keep going, and you realize the gurus keep you on track, the Dharma kings keep you on track, and realizing you're going towards dropping all expectations altogether. So you don't have to come back here. But if it's only you're only semi-conscious of it, then you just keep going from realm to realm, you come back here, and then you go to a more pliant realm, maybe, or even a less pliant one, like hellish lower realms, even less pliant than this one, because everything seems, you know, really locked down, and you just keep transmigrating around and around and around, aimlessly wandering around. If you don't bring your attention, so that you understand, recognize, you know, what's really going on. So really, singing to songs is a spiritual practice. I feel it's a very profound spiritual practice, actually. So I really do it. I really do it, you know, at least 5 days a week, hours at a time, hours at a time. And I sing either to the Beach Boys, George Jones, or Dion. Those are the three ones that I use. And because they're all great singers, they're, and great songs, great singing, and they invite harmonizing, and you can play around with the whole structure of everything and the sound of it all, and you know, like singing background to Dion with the Belmonts or the Del Saddens, I can be right with them, but I can throw in different syllables and different sounds, and it sounds even better. I can add my voice to the background vocals. And the song just sounds even better but I'm not doing the exact same thing they're doing. I might, you know, bop, 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 and doing a little bit different and swoop it in and out this way and that way, but they're still there, and it just all sounds great. So I'm improvising on the fly, just spontaneously improvising, making it more beautiful than I expect, different than I expect, more beautiful than I expect. And this helps chip away at the notion that, you know, we're somehow have to, there's a certain way we have to do it here. We have to sing it this way or something. And music is helpful, like a song like that. You have to really do it in real time. And dancing, you can do it dancing too if you want to. If you're a dancer, you can just move in ways that you don't expect. You know, we did that in the 60s, then people continue with raves and all this kind of stuff. But that's you know, the way they do it is just kind of like, I'm just, you know, whirling and they're trying to shake free of expectations. But that's not a very conscious way to do it. It's better if you, like, you see these really talented dancers. Yeah, I wish I was a talented dancer, actually. I mean, that is something that I would do also in a more plant realm. I never danced because I didn't understand, you know, exactly. I wasn't good at it, enough at it. Music was my thing. But some of these really good dancers, my wife's a great dancer. And she could just improvise. I mean, she dances with the song just beautifully, in the beat, the cha-cha-cha or something like that. But then she'll just start breaking out, syncopating her dancing with the beat. And I'd say, "What are you doing? I don't know what you're doing, but it looks great. This is even better than just the normal, you know, the cha-cha or the boogie or whatever like that. It looks it's better, but it's all syncopated and different than you expect." And she just kind of just be able to do it like that, but it still has some sort of beat and structure to it and stuff. Instead of, you know, just like whirling in a circle, like, "Oh, I'm getting dizzy and I'm raving and I'm throwing my arms up and you know, like that." I don't really go for that. You want to keep some structure. But you want to spontaneously alter the structure in such a way that it's harmonious. You want to keep harmony going because we love harmony. We want to keep something a flow, a harmonious flow. We don't want to try and just wipe out all structure, all expectations right off the bat by just becoming chaotic. You know, that's there's too much backlash from that. It doesn't work well. And we used to have such beautiful dancing in the world. I mean, look at the 60s, some of the videos, music videos back then. Oh my gosh, everybody danced so much and they were so good at it. And they knew the beats. This is, you know, the two-step, the cha-cha, the boogie, the swing, you know, the watusi, you know, this or that. There's all these different dances. And so they'd be doing it, but then they could just jive off of it, you know, and just really all sorts of different ways. That, you know, that's another spiritual practice right there. Dancing can be a spiritual practice like that. But it has to be done really, and just, you're not trying to force anything or prove anything. Just like by singing. I can stop singing too. A lot of times I just stop. So, you know, it's not like you're putting on a performance for anyone. Okay, it's not a performance. And you can tell somebody is just in the groove or they're trying to perform. There's a difference. We're not trying to perform for anyone. But the same hand, we're doing something, you know, that we're in the groove, an inspired groove. And we understand that others can see that and be inspired by it. There's a distinction there. Grateful Dead did a lot of just improvisation. You never knew what they were going to play or how they're going to play it, and the people would dance and twirl and stuff. So they were trying to, you know, get trying to chip away at their expectations, but a lot of drugs were being used there. A lot of it was a certain effort there that was really popular for a long, long time. Deadheads. So we're all trying to chip away, but it's very helpful to have the Dharma Kings, guidance of the Dharma Kings. It's very helpful to be very conscious of the big picture, that this is all just a dream, an attempt to fixate the mind, attempt to create a separate reality. And so why are we doing this? We have to understand that expectations are like a prison. We have to be careful that we don't try to leave the prison too quickly, or else we'll rush back in, we'll panic. It's like someone's been in prison for like a trillion years. You don't suddenly have the prison vanish. They take drugs and the prison's vanished. They say, "Oh my gosh, this is wonderful." They start walking around and say, "Wait a minute, where am I? Where's my prison? Wow." And then what happens? They end up hallucinating a prison, even worse prison. They say, "I'll never get out of this one. I was too scary. I gotta make it extra secure." And so they end up imagining an even extra secure prison for themselves. So you have to be very gentle and wise about how you dissolve the prison walls. A little bit at a time. Maybe the bars are a little bit farther spaced apart, and one day you're kind of looking at your jail cell and you say, "Huh, I could walk right through those, right between those bars. I mean, the bars are like 3 feet apart. I thought they used to be like 6 inches apart, and they're like 3 feet apart now." But don't walk out, okay? Don't walk out. There's a great example. You're in a prison cell, you've been there for a trillion years, and gradually you've been imagining the bars are a little farther apart. And so one day you're sitting on your cot and say, "Man, I'd like to get out of this prison, but I don't know how to. I'm not sure how to do it." And you look and the bars are 3 feet apart. So you say, "Huh, wow." So you just say, "Wow." You don't say anything else. You don't make any other conclusion. You just say, "Wow." You're not planning. You don't plan. You see, this is a great example to use. Of course you know. You can recognize immediately, say, "Oh, wow, I could just go right through there. I can go right between them." But you don't let yourself think that. You just say, "Wow, wow," and block any action. You're not taking any action at all. You just sit there quietly. You're not adverse to it. You're not pro or con. You're just neutral about it, and you just look at it and say, "Wow." You don't move. You don't get off your cot. You don't say, "Oh my God, I gotta run out quickly. 3 feet apart. Oh my gosh, now's my chance. I don't know what happened, but I gotta go." No. You just, "Wow, okay, wow." And then maybe you wake up tomorrow and they're 2 feet apart, and you just say, "Wow," meaning you've gotten scared and you've moved them closer in your imagination. You say, "Okay, now they're 2 feet apart. Okay, wow." Whatever it is, whatever it is what it is, and gradually you just get used. And the next day, maybe they're 3 feet apart again, and you just gradually get used to that. And so you may stay in the jail cell for a couple more years with the bars 3 feet apart, but now you're totally used to it, totally used to it. And so they just stay. You keep them 3 feet apart. That's it. And then gradually you realize that, well, I can walk out through those between those bars a little bit. So you might walk out just like a couple feet. Just look around and say, "Oh, that's cool." And then you walk back into your jail cell and sit down and just say, "Wow." Okay, like that. And then maybe after a year of that, you might walk down the hall a little bit and you just say, "Wow. Wow." I walk a little further and go back to the jail cell like that. And then you go to the door, and there's a door, and it's like unlocked. And you say, "Wow, it's unlocked. I could walk outside." But you don't walk outside. You go back to your jail cell. After about another year of doing that, seeing the doors unlocked, then you realize, well, the bars are 3 feet apart. The door is unlocked. Wow, I'm used to that. So this is my prison. This is how my prison is now. I'm used to the prison being this way. And once you get really used to that, then you say, "Well, okay, let me open the door." So you open the door, and then you say, then you leave the door open. Okay, for another year, the door's just open, but you don't go outside until you get really used to, well, my prison bars are 3 feet apart, the door is unlocked, and it's actually open. Okay, it stays open all the time. Okay, you get used to that. That's my prison now. And then one day you walk outside the door for a little bit, look around, say, "Oh, that's cool. That's really nice, beautiful." Then you walk back in your cell, and you do that every day for a year or so, maybe a couple years. And then finally, the year comes where you walk outside and take a kind of walk around for like a 10-minute walk and out around and look at stuff and do some things. Then you need to go back in the prison and you do that for a couple years. And then you go out, take a lot, maybe you stay out all day outside and you do that for a couple years all day. And then you say, I'll go back inside. And then eventually you stay out and you say, well, I'm going to stay out a couple days. You stay out a couple days, 2 or 3 days. Then you go back in the prison. And you do that for several years. And then you start staying out maybe a week or two. You know, you just, I'm going to take a trip. I actually take a trip and you go somewhere else. And then you come back and, oh, I'm going to go back in the prison and stay there. And after, you know, several more years of that, you just say, you know, occasionally you go back and visit the prison, occasionally. Every maybe 6 months or so, you might go back and visit. Then eventually it comes every year. You go, kind of, you say, I'm going to go back every year. I'm going to go back. And then after you do that for like about 10 years or so, you decide, you know, it's like, you kind of forget, start forgetting. Say, oh, I haven't visited the prison in 5 years. You say, maybe I better go. I say, well, maybe I'll go like every 10 years or something. I don't know, whenever I feel like it. And then, you know, time passes and maybe you go back one more time and you say, I'm just really not interested in this prison anymore. It's kind of just kind of lost interest in it. And, you know, that you just don't visit it again for a long time and kind of forget about it. That's all. So the spiritual path is like this. You got to do it like this. This is how it's done. You don't try to dissolve the prison. You don't try to dissolve the prison. You just start working with the parameters a little bit. Just imagine those bars a little farther apart, spaced farther apart. Not trying to get out of your cell, that's too frightening. But just you enjoy the aesthetics of the bars being further apart. So this is I kind of like it like this. It feels a little more, I feel a little more free if the bars are farther apart. I like that. So you just start that way, and just bit by bit, you keep shifting your expectations, the parameters of your expectations, until ultimately, as maybe 4 decades have passed, and now you're outside all the time, and you just visit the prison, you know, once every 10 years, and finally you just say, you know, I just, you know, I don't really feel like, I know it's there, it's still there. You don't bulldoze the prison, you let it stay there. But it's just, you pass it by, and you can hardly remember, you know, that you were ever in there. You just, it doesn't even cross your mind that you're ever even in there at all. But something nostalgic kind of comes a little bit. You say, yeah, I kind of have sort of a vague feeling, like, why might I feel that way? But I kind of want to keep it. It's sort of endearing, you know. It looks ugly and everything, but there's something. It's kind of nostalgic. Some sort of faint nostalgia I have for that prison. So I don't want to raise it to the ground. Just let it stay there. Let it crumble. That's okay. Like that. Now, of course, this takes patience. Of course, yeah, but it's what works. It's what works. The long and winding road that leads back to your door. George Harrison. Yeah, it can be, seems to be a long and winding road, but it's a road back to no expectations, no evaluations, absolute freedom. And we do need to reshape our expectations bit by bit by bit. I used to throw flower petals up in the air and let them fall down. You know, that's, you kind of get said, ah, yeah, this is sort of simulating the changing your expectations that, you know, flower petals can just come falling down from the sky. We'd love to have something, a gentle rain of all sorts of different beauty coming down from the sky. Why not? Why does it only have to be rain coming down? Why can't we have clouds of flowers floating through the sky? How about that? Let's just have flower clouds. And you look up at the sky, and it's just all these beautiful, gorgeous array of clouds, but they're all made of flowers, all different kinds of flowers. And then we have different clouds will give off little showers of different flowers, and they'll mix together as they're floating down through the air, and just and then as they land on the ground, they form these beautiful patterns everywhere of flowers. And you say, wow, that's so gorgeous. And as you're surfing, all these flower petals are coming down and landing on the surface of the ocean. So as you're surfing through all these flowers. And then the way, whole waves turn it turns the waves turn into waves of flowers, and you're just surfing flower waves now. Sure, absolutely, we can do that. And we can surf a wave where it turns into a beautiful barrel, and we can get back on the barrel, and then we decide that we're just going to, this barrel's going to turn into a cave or a tunnel, and we're going to walk through it, and then we come out into a different landscape altogether, like that. Different world, different realm, different pliancy or whatever. Yeah. And then we start realizing there's really aren't any worlds at all, so to speak. It's whatever we want it to be. But initially, for a while, we still want some structure, some expectation. We don't want to just completely dissolve all expectation at all, totally. Leave that for the Dharma kings. I mean, they have, remember, they have come from the higher realms where they've already gone through all this, getting used to more pliancy and expectations, to the point where they're finally able to drop all expectations and totally. But we should not burden ourselves thinking that it's that or nothing for us. You know, either do that or no. We can have experiences of realms with greater pliancy. Absolutely, we can. There's nothing preventing that. It's whatever we want to experience, we can experience. So if we want to have still some structure, that's fine. Some expectations. There's a beach there. Okay, there's a beach. But of course, as we walk along the beach, we can ask all the sand to form in all sorts of beautiful patterns. Gorgeous, just ever-flowing, subtle, beautiful patterns, and it will do so. So we could have a little bit of everything, or we can just have it just kind of random grains of sand, which is beautiful too, right? No particular pattern. And we can have the wind blow the sand, and all the little particles of sand come up, and as they get caught by the wind, they turn into little beautiful little insects floating around with gorgeous little wings. And they can all do a beautiful dance there. They do this beautiful dance and sing a little song for us. Whatever we would like. And so we miss this. I miss all this. Kids take drugs because they miss the more pliant realms. And they say, I want to go back in my imagination and imagine how it used to be. They're trying to, because this world here is really so horrible. It really is. In terms of, it's a very low type of hellish realm, this world, actually. Very much so. Where everything, the expectations are so set. The ocean, we see like beautiful surf films or something. Well, they've traveled all over the world and taken massive amounts of film and waited for just the right conditions to get those waves. I mean, most of the time, I mean, the ocean is not so as lovely as we'd like it to be at all. It isn't. I mean, it's so frustrating. I remember a day in Carmel Beach, Ocean Beach at Carmel. Used to go there sometimes looking for waves, and foggy and early morning, and it was so utterly glassy, like glass, and the waves were breaking in perfect barrels. It was just, I mean, I couldn't get out. It was too big and too strong. I don't think I was able to surf them. But it was so beautiful just to watch. The conditions were so beautiful. I've never seen those conditions again. You go down there, it's never like that. It hasn't been that way since. It's frustrating. So servers tend to always like be by constantly examining the charts and the swell and the wind and the tide and hunting for waves. Back in my day, we didn't have any of that. You just hope you get lucky. Really, that's all it was. But there was something, the thrill of not knowing what you're going to find was a big thrill, actually. Whereas now, if you know exactly what you're going to find, there's a little different vibe to it. But it just shows you that the ocean here doesn't give you what's tended to give you what you want very often. It's really frustrating. Now the Holy Spirit can tell us where to go to get what we want, but that's still frustrating here. I mean, why can't we just decide how we want the waves to be, and that's how they are? And even on a beach area, different types of waves for different people. They decide, I want this type of wave. You get a Waikiki wave, and then a little further down, you get a Banzai Pipeline wave, and then you get a Margaret River wave, and a little farther down, and different types of waves. Sure, you could. So, I'll pay the price tomorrow with all this working out. I keep doing it. I'm sore all the time. Try not to overdo it too much because then I feel terrible. So I gotta be careful. I keep trying to rotate. Tomorrow I'll go easy on certain things and I'll work out some other part of the body and so I don't get wiped out entirely. But there are times where I start to feel, oh, well, you know what I did today was 100 push-ups. That's been my goal. I wanted to reach 100 push-ups. I did it today. I didn't do it, but I did it in an interesting way. And we talk about the getting out of prison, right? Bit by bit by bit like this. Well, I've been working out doing these gas station push-ups for quite some time. And I was trying to do it like without stopping or at least, not taking a break, no breaks. So first, I was doing it kind of slowly and I'd kind of hold it a little bit and then take a break in between each one a little bit. And then gradually, I kept trying to do them with, quicker and quicker and quicker until now, like I did 40 this morning, just really fast. Bum, 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 40, it's like that. And then I took a break. I said, okay, wow, that was intense. Actually, I did 44. I did 44. Then, after taking a little break, I said, let me see if I can do 20 more. So I did 20 more real fast. I said, wow, that's 64. Then I said, let me do 20 more after another break. I was low on gas, so I had some time to do this. So I did another 20 fast. So that's 84. And I was feeling it at this point. And finally, still gas was still going. I said, I'm so close. I have 84. I could do 100, and something said, no, that's too much. Don't press it. And I said, I really wanted to reach 100. This is my goal, and I'm so close. Why not give it a try? I said, well, okay. I was kind of worried about it, and I knocked out another 16 fast. It wasn't easy. I got to the end. I said, wow, okay, I'm done. I did 100, but I did it in, I had some breaks in between, which is fine, right? It's fine. Doing 100 just right in a row rapidly, that's very difficult. And you might even, probably couldn't, you might hurt yourself actually, overstrain. So if you take a little break, it's helpful. So just like getting out of that prison, go a little ways out, go back, take a break, go back to your prison cell and just hang out and wow it, wow it, wow it, wow it. And then a little later on, go a little further out. And then come back and wow that, and eventually, you'll just kind of lose interest in the prison, living in that prison, in a prison. And this world it indeed is a prison. A prison indeed it is. A prison of expectations, collective expectations. And that's a vicious prison because it's like an invisible prison. People don't understand. Everyone speaks in a certain way, but it's expectations that move us in this world. So people don't understand that. It's amazing. how they don't really consciously work on this. Most in the world, most everything is just talk. It's just talk. It's just talk. And someone will act like a certain way, but you know, they'll talk a certain way, but you know that the way they act, they're imprisoned by what they expect of themselves, and they just like robotically keep doing that. No matter, they may say, no, I'm spiritual, I do this, and yet robotically they keep acting a certain way. So they're trying to talk their way as if they don't have these expectations, which is just a delaying tactic. They're just hoping these expectations will fixate the mind, and then they think that the happiness will come to them. So they're not really conscious of their expectations and working on them consciously. Very few do that. Very few do that here. They just think they play the delaying game by talking a good spiritual game, but not actually working on expectations. So what we advocate here is actually practice. I see the oneness. I feel the oneness. I see no bodies. Wow. I've abandoned seeing the oneness and feeling the oneness and seeing no bodies. Wow. I feel the oneness. There are no bodies. Wow. I've abandoned feeling the oneness and I see bodies. Wow. I feel the oneness and I see no bodies. Wow. I've abandoned seeing the oneness and I see bodies. Wow. So I was working on this yesterday a lot. It was so profound. So profound. Because I found I could go back and forth in my mind like this. And literally, I'd go into the oneness and I wasn't aware of any bodies at all. No, and then I'd say, okay, I've abandoned feeling the oneness and now I see bodies. And I see bodies. And then I become aware of bodies in my mind. And then I go choose to see the one. I see oneness and there are no bodies. And bodies would disappear. I wouldn't see any bodies. And then I go back and forth hundreds of times like that. And I realize it's just a simple choice in the mind. That's all that it is. You can just choose not to be aware of bodies, not to focus on bodies. And it's just like no thought, body thoughts, but just gone. And then I choose to abandon the oneness with no body thoughts. And right away, I don't feel the oneness, and I'm aware of body thoughts like that. And then I go back to, okay, I choose to feel the oneness, and there's no body thoughts, and gone, like that. So I just went back and forth there. I didn't try to fixate on either one. I'm just getting used to the prison bars being 3 feet apart. And then now they're back to 1 foot, 6 inches, and now they're 3 feet, now they're 6 inches, now they're 3 feet. Don't try to, and just say, wow, okay, prison bars are 6 inches apart. Wow. Prison bars are 3 feet apart. Wow. Prison bars are 6 inches apart. Wow. Prison bars are 3 feet apart. Wow. Prison bars are 6 inches apart. Wow. Prison bars are 3 feet apart. Wow. Prison bars are 6 inches apart. Wow. Prison bars are 3 feet apart. Wow. And you just, you know, you feel it, each one. I did it slowly enough so I could be aware of the difference like this, okay? Okay, prison bars are 6 inches apart. Wow. Prison bars are 3 feet apart. Wow. Prison bars are 6 inches apart. Wow. Prison bars are 3 feet apart. Wow. So this is, you could do this practice. I'm doing it right now and it works really well. See, your evaluation is just the same. Same reaction to prison bars being 6 inches apart or 3 feet apart. But of course, underneath, you know the significance of the difference is 3 feet apart. You can walk between them, okay? But you refuse to take any action on it. Right now, you're just flattening your evaluation of it. So you can get used to that you see them 3 feet apart. At some point, you'll just say, well, that's just the way it is. and then you can take it just the way it is. Then if you feel that way, then you can take the next step of walking between the bars. And that'll be, new expectation. You've gone past your expectations at that point. But don't try to go too fast. Don't, here, we the way to go fast is to slow down. And the wow practice helps us slow down. And it helps us get used to no evaluation at all, right? So as we do this, we're flattening evaluation, because in reality there's no evaluation, because all value is everywhere always. So there's nothing to evaluate. The notion of evaluation doesn't even arise at all. So since we're going towards no evaluation, we have to make sure we don't put a different evaluation on the prison bars 3 feet apart as opposed to the 6 inches apart. We know this is the direction, the trend we're going towards, but we want to be sure we don't fixate and grab a hold of an evaluation of it. We want to just say, okay, wow. Same evaluation of it, just wow. Because it is, after all, a dream. But it's a little, if you try to explain it all, it gets a little tricky, but if you do it, it's easy. So explanations are always become very tricky, whereas the actual practice is very simple and easy. So it's way easier to practice than it is to explain, and explaining really doesn't get anywhere. It's like stretching, but you're not really running. Stretching before the marathon without actually, starting to run or walk if you want. You can walk a marathon too. Why not walk a marathon? Now, is this enough to help people? Well, maybe during these times it's not, but at least I'm still trying, and that, I know most right now are quite alarmed, subconsciously alarmed. It's showing up in their surface behavior, their surface activity. The way it showed up very strongly for me, I realized, wow, right now people are. Inwardly, they're rather frantic. In other words, like there's a riot about ready to happen in the prison. But if you're dharmic, you don't pay attention to that. You just say, okay, the cell bars are now 6 inches. Wow, they're now 3 feet apart. Wow, okay, I've abandoned. And you say, I've accepted this, the cell bars at 3 feet apart. Wow, then say, I've abandoned cell bars at 3 feet apart. Now they're 6 inches apart. Wow. In other words, they're back the way they were before. I've abandoned the cell bars at three feet apart. Wow. I've accepted the cell bars at 3 feet apart. Wow. I've abandoned the cell bars at 3 feet apart. Wow. So you just keep practicing, mind, keep practicing. Oh, mind, keep practicing, right? Just don't pay attention to the riot. You know that you need to get out of this prison. Yeah, so just be wise and keep practicing this way, and it can happen rather quickly if you keep really focusing on like this. Just okay, so I've accepted cell bars 3 feet apart. Wow, I've abandoned cell bars 3 feet apart. Wow, I've accepted cell bars 3 feet apart. I've abandoned cell bars 3 feet apart. Wow. I've accepted cell bars 3 feet apart. Wow. I've abandoned cell bars 3 feet apart. Wow. So if you want to look at it that way, it's a very helpful way to look at it. Don't have the TV on in the cell, okay? Because you're practicing. It's very important you're practicing on this. The cell bar practice, okay? So you don't want to be looking at the television. Television's really terrible. Movies, television, they're really terrible. If you have to do something, entertainment, listen to music and don't listen, sing along with it. Because television is such a captive audience. You feel like you're such a, you're just a pair of eyes, you know, and ears. It's hard to interact with television, isn't it? But if you're driving along with a song, you can just bebop along. And I am. I'm like snapping my fingers like this, and as I'm driving, I'm snapping. I snap my fingers, and I'm moving, and I'm bopping, bebopping along, and clapping my hands like that. Yeah, and you know, and so I'm feeling it and active as I'm stuck in rush hour traffic. Why not? It's funny. Yep, some people I notice they're looking in rearview mirrors, they're looking at me. They'll be like adjusting the mirror. No, I'm just adjusting the mirror. They're really looking like that. It's an amazing place, Silicon Valley. I try not to look at drivers at all, but sometimes peripheral vision, I just see. And I'd say 9 out of 10 women here in Silicon Valley are, when the car stops, they're on their cell phone. 9 out of 10. It's unbelievable. If you look, I try to look, but occasionally I say, oh, okay, it looks like they're on their cell phone. I look, of course they are. Of course they are. Stop light immediately. The cell phone's all right there. Immediately they're on their cell phone. It's just extraordinary. On their smartphone. They're either on their smartphone or looking into a mirror, like, how do I look like this? And then they look at their mirror, they tend to see me, you know, somehow. I don't know. And I'm like, blah, 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 blah. They're like, what the heck is going on with that guy? Is he crazy or something? Because I'm trying all types of singing and different. I said, I don't know. It's. It's true. What a place, right? They probably say, I saw some maniac was like screaming in their car. Hope he's okay. Nah, I was just singing with Dion. Broke my heart. We're apart. Think she's smart. Yeah, I know. I met a girl a month ago. I thought that she would love me so, but in time I realized, like that, she had a pair of smartphone eyes. Whoa, I remember the nights we dated, always acting sophisticated, talking about high society, then she tried to make a fool out of me. Whoa, no, 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 you know. Broke my heart. And I'm like, oh. And then sometimes I'm singing loud, you know, wah, like to bust the windows out. And that's probably looking at me. What's wrong with that guy? He's like, I'm like really singing like just full blast, just super loud, intense. I can do it now. Window breaking volume. And they're looking in their rearview mirror like they're adjusting their makeup and like, whoa, I didn't expect to see that. You know. I don't know what the heck they're looking, you know, what they're looking at on their phones. It's just crazy. It's just crazy. I told a guy today, I said, I've really gotten off the internet pretty much, you know, really. And he said, yeah. He said, that's a young guy. He said, wow, yeah, that's awesome. That's great. I said, you don't really pay much attention for that much. He says, no, not that much, not that much. He's a hard-working, serious, good guy, and he has some good habits. But a lot of the guys, I mean, they're on, you know, fantasy football, baseball, basketball. I mean, these sports fantasy things is just so intense for the young people. I'm so glad I was not born in the smartphone era, because I would have been on the phone 24/7, no doubt about it. Because I knew everything about sports, and I would have been super, super fantastic at these fantasy sport leagues. But in order to keep up with it all, it becomes extremely obsessive, and I would have been on it constantly. Just to show that I, you know, could be a better GM than others. And of course, I would have enjoyed it. The competition, you enjoy it. Matching wits, you know, and savvy with others. It's super addictive. So that's one of many reasons I don't have a smartphone, is the temptation. You don't tempt fate. You got to know your limitations, know your tendencies, know your weak spots and stay away from them. Don't tempt fate, because it's going to get you if you do. So thank God I was born when I was born and not in this day and age, because they are just, I mean, they go to break and no one's talking. No one is paying the slightest attention to anybody else. They're all sitting in a chair with their smartphones, you know, just, that's all anybody's doing. And if you're not doing that, then you're just ostracized. I mean, nobody pays any attention to it. There's no conversation going on. It's just like really weird. And the scoff laws here, you know, the newest thing is just running stop signs constantly. People don't stop anymore at stop signs, especially if you're coming up to a stop sign about the same time as they are. They just kind of glide right through it so they can go ahead of you. And this isn't just men, it's women. Women in the Silicon Valley are worse than men in so many ways. They've got this entitlement complex here. I know these cashiers, and I talked to them, and I just talked one a day, and I said, what would you rather be doing, stocking or cashiering? She said, I'd rather be stocking. Stocking the shelves, you know, for new merchandise. And I said, wow, that's amazing. Why, you get tired standing? She goes, yeah, I get tired standing, but I also get tired of the customers. And I say, oh, yeah, I heard from someone else that it's this area, you get a lot of attitude, don't you? And she says, oh, my gosh, you don't, it's terrible. It's terrible. I said, well, the people that, like, have, like, entitlement complex, she goes, yeah. And this is what I've been told by cashiers is they're people that are just awful. They're so awful here. And men and women, but I've been told that the women are the worst. They're the worst. They just are like prima donnas. The prima donna. You know, that's what's going on here. You get a country girl, third world girl, and bring her into, you know, make her like, give her $10 million here and all the, you know, and they just think like, you know, they're suddenly the senora, you know, and you're just a little slave, and you know, they treat the cashiers like dirt. You know, it's unbelievable. I the stuff that I've heard is just like, wow. Yeah, and the men, some of the men are really bratty too, you know, brats and bitches here in the Silicon Valley, to say the least. And it's just like, wow. I just, you know, I'm so nice to cashiers because I know they get this now. And it's, people are just, money really messes you up. Money and power in this world, it really does. You start getting entitlement complexes and you stop stopping at stop signs. I gotta be careful now. And it's even like middle-aged women. You don't expect it from them. They're so pressed right now that they just go right through and say, "Oh, here's another car. I'm just gonna glide right through." Like in the past, you wouldn't see that. You know, women tend to play by the rules better than men in the past. Not anymore. They're breaking the rules like crazy right now. They just, you know, making up their own rules. Yeah, that's, you know, profane times. They're supposed to teach their children well. Teach your children well. Crowd distills and gnash. They're not teaching their children well. They're teaching their children just to go get whatever you can and cheat as much as you can and, you know, put yourself first as much as possible. That's the way the world is, right? Silicon Valley is that way. I talk to people, they want to get out of here. They want to go to Southern California. And people think they're crazy. I know you're not crazy. It's a different vibe down there. Different places in the world, a different vibe than here. The vibe here is me, 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 me. That's it. They will cut you off. They will blast through a stop sign. It's like, what? Before, I'd never seen, like, I mean, before you never saw something like that. Never. It's happened to be a lot now. And sometimes I get to a stop sign first. They just do a rolling stop right through theirs and just cut me off. And so I have to stay stopped. So, well, you're stopped. I didn't stop. I get to go. You know, that's the new rules here. Silicon Valley rules. I said, wow. You know, maybe I'll just turn into a flying car and just go right over you. You know, that's my, you know, new rules. Or I'll just go to another realm or another place. That's the new rules. Yeah. They think they're in a video game or something. So, There you go. What a wacky, wild, wacky world we live in, huh? About to get even more wild and wacky very soon. So do that prison bar practice and just have fun with it. You just realize that it's super profound. You have no idea how profound it is. It really opens the door to other realms to you, to other realms, consciously opens the door. Not even through death. You don't even have to go through death to go to other realms, actually. That's probably going to be a thing of the past very, very soon. Okay, Padmasambhava, Jesus, Elijah, there are various ones that just ascended. They didn't die. They just ascended. They knew this is all just a dream, that their expectations had been dropped to such an extent. They could just say, "Well, I'm gonna go to a different realm now, and so I'll have my body turn into like a light body and just go to this different realm where light body's good enough. I'll just surf in a light body, surf the flower waves in a light body." And you could have fish there too, and the fish would be like syncopated jumping out of the water for you and doing a little dance, and you'd be doing a little dance for them too, and singing to the fish. And the fish would come up to the shore, kind of near the shore of shallow water. We would be singing a beautiful song to the fish, and the fish would then be clapping their fins, saying, "Ah, so it's like a cartoon world, really, like kind of, right? Cartoons, the reason why kids love cartoons is because they came from a more pliant realm before they came into this realm. And they remember that's the way things were in that realm. It's like cartoons, like the fish are dancing and clapping, and everything is like animated in unexpected ways. Like they can do things that here they don't do that, right? So the kids are, "Oh, I love the cartoons. The everything can interact in such amazing ways like that." And the fish, maybe, what would the fish do? They'd be swimming in beautiful patterns and schooling in gorgeous ways for us, and sporting in all sorts of beautiful ways. Maybe the fish would be surfing the waves too. Yeah. And maybe fountains, the whole ocean, look at the ocean. There's like millions of fountains coming up, like Bellagio, except times a million, but all be gorgeously syncopated and choreographed of just all this beautiful water display in the ocean like that. Maybe the whales would be doing that. Millions of whales all spouting in beautiful ways. Maybe whatever we want. But first you little by little by little get used to it. Little by little by little get used to it. There are all different levels of the astral realms where nature becomes more and more compliant, pliant, more pliant, pliancy. So it's just all this gorgeous stuff just can happen as you want it to happen, and you all feel comfortable with it. It's not a problem. You don't panic and say, "Ah, I gotta go back to the world, get more structure. This is freaking me out." Problem is, as you get more and more pliancy in your experiencing, at some point you freak out if you don't let the gurus help you. You freak out, and then you take refuge back in the prison of this world. This world is really a severe prison house, very severe. So if you, the gurus, you get aligned with the gurus, the Dharma kings, then you let them decide, when you're ready for stuff, and they're there to help you with the right practices, so you don't freak out, so you don't come back to this prison house. This realm here is really a very low realm of terrible, terrible prison house. And then when you're young, you say, "Oh my God, get me out of here." Then you start acting out in all sorts of ways. Remember when we were young and how you felt kind of desperate and said, "I gotta be silly, I gotta party, I gotta do this. I just can't stand this world. This is horrible. I need more cartoons. I just got to," and yet it still is horrible. And you don't want to go through that again. That is, I sure don't. No way. So I'm paying a great deal of attention. Be conscious and just keep working at it, and just pray the Dharma kings help me out. I don't want to come back to this prison house of a realm. Let's work on this consciously here. Very great. All praise to the Dharma Kings. We ask for their help. Jesus Christ, Anandamaya Ma, Holy Spirit, Longchenpa. Jesus Christ, Longchenpa, Holy Spirit, Ramana. You know, like that. Jesus Christ, Longchenpa, Holy Spirit, Padmasambhava. The Dharma Kings, we ask for their help to help us, move us along in the right direction. Help us reshape our expectations. That's all that we ask. That's all that we're asking here, is to consciously and rather quickly, effectively, reshape our expectations. Reshape our expectations, even to the point where we can shift dimensions if we want to, right? And we may want to at some point. The world's getting in such a way that I may want to just shift dimensions. Absolutely. A lot of people may want that, actually. A lot of like, for instance, Christians, they want the rapture. That's really a dimensional shift, is what the rapture really is. It's just a dimensional shift. You know, they want it. They just don't, you know, like this situation here. But the issue there is a lot of them want things to be very fixed, just the way that they want them to be fixed. So they don't really want a pliant realm. A lot of them, they want a realm that's very fixed to expectations, but they want the expectations to be the way that they want them to be. That's not rapture ready, okay? A lot of Christians, they talk about the rapture, but they're not rapture ready at all. Rapture with Jesus is going to another dimension where the realm is much more pliant than this one, and you have to reshape your expectations, be ready for that. I mean, most of them are just talking about dates and, yes, Jesus, help, you know, I want to be raptured. But are they really reshaping their expectations to be able to handle that new realm? Or they want flowers to, you know, come down from the sky, and then there's a beautiful rain of flowers, right? And the whole realm's like this. So you have all this, you know, creativity going on with your experiencing. You have to be able to not freak out about that, because you can do it a little while, and then at some point you say, well, I want to go back home to what I'm used to, and then you want to come back here. So is that really a rapture? Not really. No, the idea of rapture is you're able to stay there in that, you know, more pliant realm, and get used to dwelling there. Okay, get used to dwelling there. That's the Jesus said he's going to go prepare a place for us and then come back and take us there to a dwelling place. Well, his dwelling place is going to be very pliant for sure for us. He made it for us, but it's not going to be some like set beautiful place where there's a lake and a mountain and a golf course and everything's just set. That's not going to be that way at all. We think of paradise as being, oh, a lovely park. Now, paradise is a more pliant realm where the you know, we want blooms on the roses, boom, there's the blooms on the roses. We want blooms on the hibiscus, boom, you know, there's blooms on the hibiscus. We want the palm trees to do a swaying dance for us, they do a swaying dance for us. We want the palm trees to move over here, they move over there. We got a golf course here, we want the you know, the sand traps to move, the sand traps move. Yeah, so there's still some structure, but we're able to move stuff around with our minds. That's the dwelling place that Jesus has prepared for us. So if we're not ready for that, we're not ready to be raptured. But if we are ready for it, we are ready. Now we can keep the lake in a similar place, you know, we can't, but we can then play with the dance of ripples upon it, or the reflections off the lake. You know, we can play in any which way we want. So many different ways we can play with our landscape without overdoing it, you know, trying to just make it turn into anarchy or chaos. We don't have to do that, no. We don't have to have the mountains like spinning around in circles, you know. We could, but we don't have to do that. We can we can maybe shift them in little ways, start shifting a little ways, and take hike, and every time we take a hike along the same trail, the whole landscape looks a little different, you know, different crystalline structures, and you know, just get used to, like, wow, you know, things keep changing because we want them to change here. So That's what the rapture is really about. It's not going to some fixated realm. There's different realms, of course. Different realms. There's a death-free realm, but the realm that really helps us so much is this one that is more pliant. Okay, the death-free realm also helps, which is experience of nothing's ever died. Nothing's ever been sick. Nothing's ever died. And that gives us some help also, realizing that we can have a dream. The dream is to try to induce abnormal mind, but see, mind can imagine and experience as long as it wants it to, okay? So it can imagine a realm where the trees are like billions and billions of years old, and they're just gorgeous and perfect and so beautiful, and they've never... There's no aging cycle at all. None. That's quite an... Death-free realm's quite an experience. And so we just have to recognize what this is about, and that this realm here, this world, is really a very high security, horrible, horrible prison. And especially the minds that are here now, they're so intent on turning this into a maximum security prison. So intent on that. They don't even know about the saints. They don't even know there's ever been miracles in this world. They think that's just a myth or a sign of mental illness. I mean, they are so far down in a hellish type of mindset. They want to turn this into just an insanely maximum prison type of realm. And that's the mindset of those that's what they want this world for. So, you know, it's... Because of that, you know, we're likely to go to a different realm at some point where it's more the way we want it, which is very pliant, very pliant. Surfs up, you know, surfs up every day there.
Really?
Surfs up, dude, you know, beach party. Absolutely. Just the way, wow, I can hear music. Awesome. That's it. Wow.